Hello there! Welcome to Skeleton Key Productions. I'm Quan Grace Cocon. Let's get into the video. In today's video, we're going to be asking the question of what if the Crimean War never happened? Now, if you want more details into the nitty-gritty of that conflict, I would highly recommend watching the Armchair Historian. Yeah, that channel goes into a lot of detail on that. I'll hopefully remember to have a link in the description. But yeah, so this video is not going to look at the finer details of the war, it's going to look at the bigger picture. So like, what were the different war aims of the different sides, and what would have been the consequences if it never happened? So in the context of this alternative history, we're going to say that Britain and France stay out of the conflict, they don't invade the Crimea, and they just let the Russian Empire expand into the declining Ottoman Empire. So just to give a bit of context, Russia was expanding, and its war aims were threefold. One, obviously to take land from the declining Ottomans. Two, they wanted to unite the Orthodox and Slavic speaking people of the Balkans and that whole region in general, because after the fall of Constantinople in 1453, Constantinople had been referred to as the Second Rome, because obviously you had the Byzantine Empire, where the Roman Empire had been split in two. So one side ended up in the end going towards Catholicism, the other side went to Eastern Orthodoxy. And so with the fall of Constantinople, Moscow ended up taking up the mantle of being the Third Rome. And so it had been the war aim of Eastern Orthodoxy for a good 400 years to be able to retake Constantinople from the Muslim Turks. Add to that, obviously, this idea of Slavic nationalism. So many Slavs in the Balkans were still under Ottoman rule, and so the Russians wanted to, you know, be the defender of the South Slavs. And they also, since the time of Peter the Great, wanted to establish a blue water navy. So a blue water navy is basically having a navy with access to the sea all year round. They wanted warm water ports, so most of the ports in Russia, they freeze in winter, and so they don't have, you don't have full access to the sea. So for most of Russian history, as much as on the map it looks like they have a huge coastline, in reality, because of the Arctic, they are actually in many ways a landlocked country. They only have a handful of places where they have like year-round access to the sea. And so having ports in the Black Sea, especially in Sevastopol, especially in, if they were to take it, Constantinople, would be a huge strategic gain to them. And this has been something which, since the days of Peter the Great, they've been wanting to establish. So the Ottoman Empire was obviously declining, and they just wanted to swoop in and take the pickings. But we have to understand that the French and the British got involved, and they got involved for very different reasons. So the French, they got involved, well, they did it for clout. They do anything for clout. We do anything for clout. Anyway, so Emperor Napoleon III, yeah, he basically did it for clout. So A, it was to distract the French public at home, who were quite hostile to him and, you know, didn't really like how he was governing the country. But two, he wanted to kind of go along this kind of mantle of being the protector of the Christian people in the Middle East, and especially in the Holy Land. And he wanted the Catholic Church to be more dominant there, and wanted that to be the defender of the faith of the people there, rather than the Orthodox Church in Russia. So there weren't any like French geopolitical strategic aims that was there. It was more just, like I say, for the clout of what the Emperor wanted. Now the British had a very different aim. They wanted to secure the Eastern Mediterranean, because even though the Suez Canal wasn't built until 1867, they still wanted control over that general region, because that's obviously a shortcut to India and obviously their possessions in the East. Being able to secure the Eastern Mediterranean from any kind of threat from Russia was something which they really aimed for. This is the reason why Britain got involved in the war. And this is also why they struck in Crimea, because Crimea has Sevastopol, which even today is a major Russian port. And so they wanted to take the Russians out of there, slow down their ability to be able to have a blue water navy, because they recognised that over time, the Russians would then be a strategic threat to their interests in the Eastern Mediterranean if this had been allowed to continue. And so they wanted to kind of put a stop to it, or at the very least put a damper on it for as long as they could. So now that we've got the different war aims of the different powers out of the way, we're going to go through step by step, you know, country by country, what would have had the most major effect if this war hadn't actually happened as it did. But before we do all that, you have to hit the like button, because obviously that gets it so that more people see it, you know, it boosts the algorithm. And obviously you share with your friends, subscribe if you haven't already. Check out a lot more of our videos. I think we've got like 15 videos at least for this alternative history playlist. We've got many other playlists as well, so definitely give them a check out. But anyway, enough of my shameless plug, let's get back to the video. So the most major impact would have been on the Russians. Yeah, you know, Russia was really humiliated in this war, and it really was a shock to Russian society. They come off of the glory of, you know, being triumphant in the Napoleonic Wars, you know, having a large part to play in the defeat of Napoleon, and also in the uprisings and revolutions of 1848 in Europe. Russia was part of the Holy Alliance, yeah, between Austria, Prussia and Russia, where they basically crushed all kind of revolutionary movements on the continent. And so they were kind of seen as the almost like the policemen of Europe in a way. You know, having the military as it was, which was basically a large conscript peasant army, that was fine for like, you know, early 19th century kind of things. But the problem was that modern times require modern technology, modern tactics, modern training, everything, right? And so this Crimean War really shows the difference between the modern British and French armies compared to the archaic Russian army. It was a huge shock because, you know, Russia thought that it was indestructible, and this war showed just how backwards their own military was. It led to their army becoming much more professional. It led to a lot more drill, a lot more technology, and also the infrastructure, you know, the roads, the railways, etc., connecting the different places. Russia spent a lot more on this. And on a societal level, Russia still in those days had something known as serfdom. We had it in England and in most of the other places in Europe in like the Middle Ages. So basically, it's not exactly slavery, but it's a thing of peasants are tied to their land and they have like a feudal lord, and yeah, like they can't really do much. It's kind of slavery, but it's not exactly slavery. It's like one level above. And so that was still up in Russia up until 1861. And so part of the reason why Tsar Alexander II, who we'll get onto in the next video, so definitely check that out on what if the Russian Revolution never happened. Although it's many, many years before the Russian Revolution, this man and this event was very pivotal. We'll get onto that in the next video. But anyway, part of the reason why he ended serfdom is because he recognised that actually the only way to get Russia to modernise and to have a modern military and a modern like country was to abolish serfdom and move into the 19th century as such, rather than being stuck in the Middle Ages. And so on a societal level, if there had been no Crimean War, would they necessarily have modernised as quickly as they did? Would they have abolished serfdom when they did? Probably not. Like, it probably would have ended at some point, but who knows when? It could have taken many, many decades. If an institution like that had lasted for hundreds of years longer than it did in the rest of Europe, what's to say that it couldn't have lasted into the 20th century? Who knows? Also, for our American audiences, a nice little side effect of this war was that Russia was very scared that Britain would end up taking their possessions in Alaska. Yes, so for those who didn't know, Alaska used to be a Russian territory. However, it wasn't that valuable at that time. They didn't know that there would be gold there and oil there, etc., etc. So they was like, okay, we don't want the British to take over this. Who can we just give it to who's not really a major power, like who's, you know, America? Because at that point, America wasn't that powerful. And so the Americans bought it off them for, I think, something really small, like $2 million, yeah? And then obviously they then found oil and they found gold, etc., etc. And strategically speaking, in the Cold War, it would have been really valuable for the Russians to have had a colony in North America. But anyway, so yeah, so that's a nice little side effect of that war, because they was like, oh, okay, we don't want the British to have this, but this is kind of costing us a bit too much. That's why they end up sending it to the Americans. So if they hadn't lost this war, they probably would have kept on to Alaska. Now, the next country that was impacted by this was obviously Britain. So, you know, like the charge of the Light Brigade, you know, the Battle of Balaclava, you know, like all these kind of things. On a cultural level, the Crimean War is something really, really pivotal. It's something taught to us, even it was taught to me in primary school even. Cannons to the left of them, cannons to the right of them, volleyed and thundered, into the valley of death rode the 600. You know, that's one of my favourite poems, right? And it's all talking about how the bravery of like the British soldiers basically being led to charge straight at some cannons. Yeah, and end up, well, they won that battle, but it was really, really disastrous. It was really poorly led. Many of the British soldiers and the British public back home were like, this war was completely unnecessary. This war was led in a disastrous way. And while we did win some strategic aims, it wasn't worth it for the amount of men that we ended up losing. And there's something to note as well, that again, on a medical level, this war in many ways helped Britain, because, you know, modern nursing, a lot of like modern medicine end up like being really boosted up by this war. So everyone knows about Florence Nightingale and Mary Seacole. So they end up obviously starting their careers in this war. And that's how they rose to prominence, because of the valuable contribution that they made to nursing and showing that women could be great nurses. And so obviously most of nursing nowadays ends up being predominantly made up of women, but that profession, it wasn't really seen as something that women ought to go into. Them proving themselves there on the battlefield really showed that actually women were valuable within the realm of medicine, and they played a really prominent role. Also, the casualty rates for this were ridiculous, yeah. As with most wars, yeah, like before the modern era, the vast majority of people who died in those wars were due to disease. So for instance, we had 3,000 British people who died as a result of like actual like fighting, but 19,000 of them died from diseases. A similar picture happens in the French military as well. You have 8,500 people dying like from combat, and yet you have 75,000 people dying from disease. The Russians, it's even worse. They end up losing 36,000 people to direct combat, but end up losing 377,000 people from disease. And even for the Turkish military, who, you know, you'd think were more acclimatized to this whole kind of conflict, 10,000 of them died from direct combat, and yet 24,500 end up dying from disease. So yeah, it was terrible. The vast majority of people who died in this war died from disease. Yeah, so this really showed like medical practitioners and also military planners that actually what they needed to do was, you know, actually deal with this, because you can't end up having a situation where the vast majority of your army ends up dying from preventable diseases. So as a result, this was the last war in which the casualty rates were as high as this when it came to disease. So by the time, for instance, you get to the British fight in the Boer War, by the time you end up getting to the Russo-Japanese War, by the time you end up getting to World War One, you end up finding where the vast majority of casualties end up being through direct combat, and the amount that die from disease is significantly less than that. So the Crimean War was really pivotal in the realm of medicine. So without it, the medical profession would have been really held back. It's quite interesting human development that war seems to be the greatest catalyst for positive change. So yeah, it would be nice if we could kind of make these changes without having to fight all these wars, but it is what it is, I suppose. Now, considering that the French put in far more troops than the British did, and, you know, and had many more casualties, you'd expect the psychological effects on the French and, you know, everything to be a lot bigger, right? Actually, no. Because, like I said, the French did it just for clout. This was just seen as another stupid, pointless imperial venture led by Napoleon III. After the Franco-Prussian War of 1871, where the French were kind of defeated, they end up overthrowing the emperor. And with the new republic, they really didn't care what happened. Yeah, so Russia ended up taking advantage of this, because in the Treaty of Paris of 1856, which concluded the war, it said that they weren't able to build any ports in the Black Sea. However, obviously with the French Republic, they was like, all right, cool, we'll set these up. The French Republic made no opposition to this, and the British and Turks were like, well, if the French aren't going to enforce it, we can't be bothered either. So as a result, it was kind of a complete waste of time, and the French didn't get anything out of it. It didn't really leave much of an effect. It was just another thing that ticked them off and reminded them of how much they didn't like the French emperor. And finally, with regard to the Ottomans, I don't think it really made much difference. All it would have done was speed up their already like inevitable decline. I think if obviously the Russians had advanced and taken Constantinople, modern Turkey today would look very different without modern day Istanbul. But yeah, I think that the Ottomans were bought a little bit of extra time by this. Maybe that gave them a little bit more time to kind of to industrialize. Maybe they wouldn't have been able to defeat the British in the Gallipoli campaign, for instance, as we discussed in our last video, if they hadn't like had this kind of sudden shock and realized they need to industrialize more. It's not so clear what difference it would have necessarily made for the Ottoman Empire. But I think most certainly within this, if the British and French hadn't intervened, the biggest impact would have been towards Russia. So Russia, as we discussed, their war aims were obviously to take control over the Black Sea. They wanted to, you know, be the protector of the Orthodox Church in the whole region, and also to have this kind of pan-Slavic kind of union. Russia would have expanded. It probably would have taken Constantinople in time. And yeah, it would have had a huge, huge dominant role within the Eastern Mediterranean and within the Balkans. And yes, I think that eventually they would have ended up clashing with British interests. You already had in the Middle East, like in Central Asia, you had the so-called Great Game, which was the geopolitical tensions between the Russian Empire and the British Empire, so the British being in India and the Russians being in Central Asia. And yeah, so we already had that tension there. So if you also had that tension in the Eastern Mediterranean, which is obviously what the British feared, they feared the Russian Navy disrupting their supply routes to the Suez Canal. Yes, who knows how that could have turned out. I think certainly we would have had a much more powerful Russia in this timeline, but I think the societal effects of this would have meant that they wouldn't have industrialized as quickly as they did. They wouldn't have abolished serfdom when they did. And I think that would have also had many societal issues going far longer than that. So yeah, so I hope you enjoyed that video. It was it's quite an interesting kind of war, and I don't think there's been many people who have done many alternative histories on it. And so yeah, so that's kind of why, and it's always been something that I've been fascinated in. So yeah, I hope that you enjoyed that video. So the next video, as we said, is going to be on what if the Russian Revolution never happened, and our departure point will actually be 1861. So definitely stay tuned for that, and yeah, hopefully you enjoyed this video. Don't forget to hit the like button, subscribe if you haven't, share with your friends, and watch a lot more of our great videos. And in the meantime, have a great day, and bye.